Welcome back for more lessons in sentence diagramming. You may have noticed that after completing 10 lessons, you still are confronted with various sentences in life that you don't know how to diagram. We're going to try to clear that up with some of these extra lessons, starting with verbals. And there are three types of verbals: gerunds, participles, and infinitives. So let's look at diagramming gerunds first. Okay, so gerunds are words that end in ing but function as nouns, even though they are formed from verbs. So, for instance, the word running is a gerund in the following sentence: running is fun. And you'll see that running is sitting in a noun spot, in the subject spot of our diagram. The forked line goes right where the subject goes. The ing goes on the bottom step, and the rest of the word goes on the top step. Now, gerunds can also take on modifiers or complements. So, for example, let's look at the following sentence: running marathons is fun. Running what? Running marathons. So you're going to see a direct object included with this gerund. So on the forked line, on the bottom step, goes the ing, along with the object marathons. And on the top line is the rest of the gerund, R-U-N-N in this case. Let's look at one more. I like swimming in lakes. So here the noun is in the position of the direct object, and the gerund sits on a forked line with the ing, as always, on the bottom step. And the rest of the word, swim, on the top of the line. And you'll see that this gerund, like any other noun, can be modified. In this case, modified with an adjectival prepositional phrase in lakes. Okay, so let's try some out. One tip for diagramming and recognizing gerunds is just simply looking for ing words, and then, importantly, deciding whether or not that word functions as a noun. Let's look at number one. My sister and I enjoy laughing. My sister and I enjoy what? Laughing. So laughing is the direct object here, and direct objects are nouns. So here we have a gerund. Good luck with this. Enjoy. Try to do all five. We're only going to have five to practice, so do all of them, and good luck. And here we have our answers, the diagramming gerunds exercises. Let's go back to number one, my sister and I enjoy laughing. So my sister and I is the compound subject, enjoy is the verb, and there's a direct object that follows it. Enjoy what? Enjoy laughing. You'll notice the ing part of the gerund goes on the bottom step. All right, let's take a look at number five. I dream of diving to the bottom of the ocean. Bunch of prepositional phrases in a row. So I dream is the subject and verb. I dream how? I dream of diving. The object of the preposition is a noun, and in this case, it's a gerund. So on the bottom step goes the ing, as always. The div goes on the top step, followed by two more prepositional phrases. How'd you do here? I think these are fun, but they do get a little confusing when you mix it in with everything else that we have and will study. So keep practicing. Let's take a look at participles now. Participles are words that are formed from verbs but now function as adjectives. These are words that end in ing, d, p, or n. And here's how to diagram them. So let's look at a sample. Shooting stars are pretty. What kind of stars? Shooting stars. So here we see a participle functioning as an adjective, modifying stars, and it's diagrammed on a curved sort of swooping line like this. Like gerunds, a participle can take on a complement or modifier. So let's take a look. Throwing rocks across the water, my friend smiled. Which friend or what kind of friend are we talking about here? my friend throwing rocks across the water. So here we have a long participial phrase functioning as an adjective of the noun friend. And you will see throwing is on a curved line, just like shooting was. And it gets a direct object. In this case, throwing what? Throwing rocks. Where? Across the water. So across the water is an adverbial prepositional phrase because it's modifying the adjective that is throwing. In other words, it is modifying the participle, which is throwing, that functions as an adjective for the noun friend. And as you can see here, participles like gerunds can take on complements. They can take on modifiers. They can take on adverbs, adverbial prepositional phrases, etc. Okay, so let's try some of this out. It's a little tricky at first. And here we go. Each of these sentences contains a participle or participial phrase. Let's see how you do. One hint for identifying and diagramming participles, like gerunds, is to find the potential participle word and then check if it's functioning as an adjective. And here we have our answers. So let's look at number one. Have you seen my biking shorts? Well, it's a question, so the H is going to be capitalized. Subject is you, verb have seen. Have seen what? Shorts, so the direct object is shorts, which is also a noun, and it's modified by a participle, biking. You'll see biking is on the curved line with the ing on the straight part of the line. Number two, yuck. I hate burnt toast. Burned toast. This is very similar to the previous one. I, subject, hate, verb. What? Hate, toast. Toast is the direct object, modified by the adjective that is a participle. How about number four? The plants growing near the window need water. Which plants? Plants growing near the window. So the adjective is growing, which is a participle in this case. You can see it's diagrammed on a curved line with the ing taking the straighter spot. Near the window is the prepositional phrase that is modifying growing. Okay, so you'll get used to these with a little bit of practice. And now it's time to look at infinitives. Let's look at infinitives, our third type of verbal. And remember, verbals are words that are formed from verbs but don't function as verbs any longer. And infinitives function in a number of ways, as nouns, as adjectives, as adverbs, and they are diagrammed using a forked line like this one in the sample here. I love to run. I love what? Direct object is to run. So here we see infinitive is functioning as a noun, as a direct object. Like the other types of verbals, infinitives can take on complements and modifiers. So let's take a look at the sample. I swore to tie my shoes tighter in the future. Okay, so I swore what? Here we have another noun. We have an entire infinitive phrase. To tie my shoes tighter. Okay, so we see that to is on the diagonal line, just like the previous sample. Tie is on the straight line, and this takes on a direct object as well. So to tie what? Tie my shoes. So here we see shoes as the complement to the infinitive to tie. Whose shoes? My shoes. Tie how? Tie tighter. When? In the future. Okay, so now we're really using a lot of our skills that we have accumulated thus far. Okay, so when diagramming infinitives, you should look for the word to, and then look for the verb that follows it, and then recognize that collectively, it's going to function as some part of speech. So you want to figure out what part of speech to bark, for example, is functioning as. So In number one, my dog loves to bark at cars. To bark is its own thing. It's an infinitive. My dog loves what? Loves to bark. So here you have to resist the temptation to assume that to bark is a prepositional phrase, because it's not. Remember, prepositional phrases include the preposition and the object of the preposition. And the object of the preposition is always a noun or a pronoun. Here we see to bark, and bark is a verb, but to bark is an infinitive. Okay, give these a shot. Get some practice in. You might make a few mistakes, but when we look at the answers, that'll be a chance to correct them. And as we know, mistakes are nothing to fear. It's the inability to fix our mistakes that's a problem. But mistakes, of course, as my daughter likes to say, mistakes are a chance to learn. So good luck. Here we go with the answer to diagramming infinitives. Number one, my dog loves to bark. Dog, subject, loves what? Loves to bark. So to bark is the infinitive. It's also the direct object. So the infinitive is functioning as a noun here. And it's diagrammed as so. Two on the slanted line, bark on the straight line, all sitting on a forked line. Number two, to master a new skill takes patience and persistence. Okay, and here we see the infinitive phrase, to master a new skill, is functioning as the subject. So this whole phrase is basically taking the spot of the noun. Just like the previous one, two is on the slanted line. The verb part, master, is on the straight line. And this takes on a complement. This takes on a direct object of its own. So master what? Master skill, a new skill. Okay, verb takes what? Compound direct object, patience and persistence. Good job if you got that one right. That one was a little tricky. How'd you do with the rest of these? Here we see in number five, the puppies barked to get my attention. And here we see barked how? Barked to get my attention. So this is a little funny looking, because to get my attention is the infinitive. It's also functioning as an adverb, modifying the verb barked. And it needs a little extra space because of the fact that there's a forked line. So this entire adverb infinitive phrase, to get my attention, is diagrammed like this. If you figured that out, congratulations. You'll see a similar version of that in number three. Okay, let's move on to one last exercise where we combine all these together. It's always nice to have a chance to combine multiple exercises together, so we're going to do that here. Some earlier tips. If you see the ing word, take a moment and figure out what part of speech it is, because if it's a noun, then you know it's a gerund, and if it's an adjective, then you know it's a participle. Also, if you see the word to, decide if it's followed by a verb or by a noun or pronoun. If it's followed by a verb, then you know you have an infinitive. Then it's a matter of figuring out what part of speech it's functioning as, and then diagramming it accordingly. Okay, good luck. Enjoy these. Some answers. Number one, running with scissors is extremely dangerous. Okay, what is extremely dangerous? Running is. So running is functioning as a noun here. It sits in the subject slot. The ing is on the second step. Run is on the rest. And running how? Running with scissors. Interestingly, the prepositional phrase with scissors is an adjectival prepositional phrase because it's modifying the noun that is the gerund running. So even though it answers the how question, which is traditionally an adverb question, you can just look at the diagram and see that it's functioning in the position of an adjective, and thus it's an adjectival prepositional phrase. How about number two? My sister and her friend try to hide from me. So we have a compound subject, sister and friend. Verb tried, direct object, tried what? They tried to hide. And here we have an infinitive diagram with B2 on the slanted line, hide on the straight line, and to hide, how? To hide from me. So like number one, we have the answer to a how question in the form of an adjectival prepositional phrase. So we can start to see a pattern here in verbals. Remember, verbals originate from verbs, but they become some other part of speech. But that how question, that adjective question, translates here. So without confusing anybody too much, from me, because it's modifying the noun, that is the infinitive to hide, is an adjectival prepositional phrase. Number three, reading the dictionary, Lisa told me the definition of the word. Okay, so Lisa, subject, told, verb, told what? Definition is the direct object. To whom? Me is the indirect object. And reading the dictionary is the participial phrase. So here we see read is on the curved line, ing, on the straighter part. Reading what? Reading the dictionary. So dictionary is it's a noun complement to the participle reading. I have talked through the first three examples. Try to take over my role for yourself and talk through the answers to numbers 4 and 5 as if you were teaching or explaining this to somebody else. And whenever you get a chance to teach something that you're learning, it's always a better way to learn it. As Stephen Covey used to say, to learn, teach. When you're learning something, pretend you're going to be teaching it later. You have a much better chance of learning it and learning it deeply. So that's always a trick. Anytime you're learning something from videos like these or anywhere else, pretend you're going to teach it, or even better, actually go ahead and teach it. So why don't you go ahead and teach this stuff to somebody else? Now we have enough diagramming skills under our belts to diagram most language that we're going to find out there in the world, in English, but not all. So we have a few more lessons coming up. Enjoy.